Warner Brothers accused of payola for positive reviews of The Flash. I actually buy this 110%. They're not even talking about the American market. They're talking about the Chinese market here. But given all of the things that random celebrities were saying, like when Tom Cruise is like, it's the greatest superhero movie ever. I'm like, do you even watch superhero movies, dude? Did you see that? When he was saying positive things, yep. I was like, what type of reach around did they give you for your Mission Impossible thing? Where are they going to now come out and promote Mission Impossible?
Mm.
Right?
Maybe.
Is payola like the term used?
I guess payout for paying for reviews.
Yeah.
So it says DC's long threatened film adaptation of The Flash debuted this past weekend to average, mostly meh reviews. A very disappointing B cinema score. Is a B really a disappointing cinema score?
Yeah.
It is?
Yeah.
It says, but now it's been widely released. The Flash is going to be a financial catastrophe for Warner Brothers just in time for the anticipated DCU revamp. This reassuring for those who don't believe that the early praise that David Zaslav, James Gunn, and Tom Cruise, Jaden Smith, well, who the hell cares what Jaden Smith thinks about a movie, and Stephen King, among others, had to say about the film. And they get in here. So his name's Gavin Feng, and he's a well-respected Chinese box office reviewer. Right? So he says, Warner Brothers China has been widely accused of paying critics and social media influencers for good reviews of The Flash by local audiences over the past weekend. Many people are saying they'll never ever believe any positive reviews and reactions for any WB movie. That's crazy. He also, the guy points out in this article that the American journalist who pointed this out seemed like that was only something that could happen in China and that it wouldn't happen here in America, as if American journalists would be somehow more, what would be the term for that? Have more integrity?
Integrity, yeah.
Yeah, so he says, for the record, local audiences actually like The Flash with an 8 out of 10 Dubin, is it Duban? Is that what their thing is there? Is that the website that they use? Mm-hmm. I know they use Weibo. For social media. He says it's been criticized by hands, fairs, and trolls, especially just in time for Guardians 3. He says, since no developed critic system, local distributors have strictly controlled critics, even ticket sales, like, and I can't pronounce these words. So do you think this is one of those things that could end up coming here? Like, if this is happening overseas, it's very clearly probably happening here.
I think it happened here first. I just think it wasn't with dollar bills. It was with access.
It's already done through experience.
Yeah. And parties and, like, making you feel like you're part of the in-group. Like, yeah. I've watched every YouTube channel that I liked talking about movies from 2014 fall into this, where it's, like, you can't buy a word that they say. Like, it's just... We're doing our next show from the premiere. We're doing it at whatever, you know. It's like, it's just, ugh.
It reeks.
Yeah. Well, it is fake.
Yeah.
But they don't hide it well. There's no.
That's
then,
what I mean.
Like, and there are people who like the access media. That's why, like, access media.
Hollywood.
Access Hollywood is a thing. But for people who are watching it purely from a, I guess. Curious standpoint, not like
people who actually want to be informed. And
people
want
to be informed.
Review.
Yeah, thank you. It just rings hollow, and that's why I think that entire like movement has since died, except for maybe one in John Campia, who's but they all like Collider. It all collapsed. Like all of those things got really big for a while. And it's all gone.
I watched Collider in 2014, 2015. It was very, very big at the time.
Yep.
It does feel that way. Like in a lot of instances, like I know Clownfish TV has talked about, they used to have journalists, you know, like media access to Disney, mm-hmm. no more, mm-hmm. because you know, if you speak out and you decide to be critical of anything that they make, why would they let you in? Yeah. Right. Like they absolutely want to keep you out. And they own, I mean, these corporations own all these magazines anyways.
Yeah.
Like Disney is just one company like that owns a ton of smaller companies underneath it. So you're getting paid press in a different way, right? Like one of my favorites is like when you start seeing the positive articles come out on sites, like there was one like on New York Post this week. It's like how Ezra Miller went from persona non grata to hero in less than a year. I'm like, who wrote this?
Yeah.
And how much did they get paid?
Yeah.
Like that's some selling of the morals to be like, this kid who's accused of grooming children and all of these horrible crimes, But my God, I mean, they even sell their worlds, to be fair.
This was the one that there was some evidence that came out, right? It wasn't just an accusation.
But they'll sell their motives other ways. I've seen positive things about Mel Gibson movies from from sites that hate Mel Gibson because around the time those movies come out, the studio wants them to write something positive about it. Right.
Oh, so, we got a couple of super chats, $20.
Yeah, go for it.
They're both from Ballistic Boy. The first one's no comment, but thank you for the super chat. And the second one is... Wonder Woman's No Man's Land scene is a great example of feminism done right. Man and women have different strengths and point of views that help society move forward. That scene encapsulates that.
Yeah.
And what's up, Ballistic Boy? Thanks for joining and hanging out.
Yeah.
I met Ballistic Boy.
Did you?
Yeah, he came out when we went out to DC for the meetup.
Oh, awesome.
Filmed some skate footage.
Woo! Bryce. Thank you, guys. Yeah, like when you lean into the strengths. It's party time. Sure, it interrupts the show, but it's my joy that people really love, right? That's the smile on my face is enough to excuse the fact that the conversation has gotten interrupted several times over. Yeah, like leaning into the traits that make men and women. Okay, here's an example of it on TV. So in the show Bones, at the start of the show, Emily Deschanel's character was portrayed in the way they show every female character on TV. She was good at martial arts. She could always defend herself and take care of herself. But eventually they realized that what audiences wanted was to watch her be a scientist, and they want to watch the burly, tall David Boreanaz be the one who protects her. Because that leans into how the actual human experience is on the majority, not all the time, but the majority of the time. That speaks to what women might seek in a situation like that and what men would seek to be in a situation like that. So,
what was that slasher film we just watched where like the woman takes over and saves everybody? Well, actually, I think she kills everybody.
Oh, You're Next?
Yeah.
Yeah.
It was like, it was all right for a slasher film, but...
Who is the bad guy at the end of Scream 4? The one who plays, I don't remember the actress's name. Jill? I don't remember. So she's tiny. Mm-hmm. Okay. So you watch the whole of Scream 4, and the ghost face is like 6'3", and extremely mobile and versatile and just really, really strong. And then like when they do the reveal, he's suddenly a foot shorter. And you're just like, nobody's buying this. Like, it just very, very stupid. Didn't need to happen. I forget that actress's name. That's on me. And usually I'm the one who remembers this stuff. If somebody remembers her name in the chat, what was her name in Scream 4? I can't remember.
Who does she play?
She plays, I think the character's name is Jill, but I could be misremembering that, but it is what it is. So like, I think you're 110% right. I think access media is actually is a huge part of the problem here. And we've just found a way to subsidize it. These companies have found a way to subsidize it.
I haven't seen this, but was it played by Emma Roberts?
Yes. Okay. Emma Roberts. She's tiny.
The other thing is that they just hire people they know will write that. And you don't have to do anything.
Kind of like middle management is going to be the end of all of these companies. Yeah. Like, can you pinpoint a certain time when you feel like this took over? Was it around The Last Jedi? Not to turn that into discussion, but
I think it was around the time of The Force Awakens.
So like when people were like, had questions about it, it didn't get the reviews that people thought it did. Because they thought that remaking they thought that would work, right? And people were like, I have questions. Yeah. Like, I don't know if you can sustain a new franchise by simply remaking the previous movie.
Yeah, that I would say that's when it started for all of it, too, because before that, Marvel wasn't exactly the juggernaut. That was around the time of Captain America and the Winter Soldier.
Dude, I loved Movie Talk at that time, too. OG, I loved AfterBuzz TV.
AfterBuzz
TV
loved, was good.
I loved Movie Talk. I loved all of those, and it started to go so far downhill. I still remember, one of the first times I really started noticing identity politics showing up in stuff like that was, in one of those things, and they were reviewing the show Blindspot, and one of the reviewers just had this callous reaction. It was like, why are all the... She was saying, she's like, could we have some people that aren't straight white men being the bad guys once in a while? But she wasn't saying it in a way, because they were straight. She's saying, we just need less white people in this. And I was like... that's par for the course now. At that time, it started to stand out to me more.
I one of the things that like indicated how this was happening was Jeremy Johns when he made the move there to join all of those things. And then very shortly after, he was like, I'm going back to where I came from.
Yeah.
And
did he ever explain why?
Oh, yeah. Not he implied why. He was like, I like to be able to say the things I want to say.
Yeah.
And what the culture there is like, the culture, he's like, there's a lot of nice people. I hung out, worked with a lot of nice people. He's like, but the culture there is garbage. Yeah. I was like, couldn't agree more.
If you can't say what you want to say, what's the point of doing a job where it's about your thoughts on something like that? I can't think of a worse place to be trapped for something like that. Like, it's like if you're just doing straight news, that's not the same as like journalist who just rewrites articles, right? Like that's a term, but it's not meant to be derogatory. It's like some people's job is just to write up, you know, just the base level facts for a story.
Yep.
There's not a lot of creativity there.
Yep.
That's fine. But if you're being like, imagine being like, we want to hire you to write op-eds, but then we want to tell you what the hell you're allowed to write an op-ed about. To that degree, like, obviously there's oversight for stuff like that for a lot of these sites, but it doesn't sound very fulfilling.
Mm-hmm.
Like, especially if you view what you do as a form of art. I don't know,
man. This is very depressing to watch. Like, it is that entire fall of that has diminished my interest in the subject entirely. Like, it's and it
in what
in like this type of media. Like, I loved it. Like, I thought that was. You know, it was an industry I wanted to work in.
Yeah.
And it's like, just seeing how it is and how it actually is, it's like, never mind.
Do you think it's solely because of access, or do you think it has other implications?
I know it has massive. It's just how
I mean, implications. Like, do you think it's solely about access, or do you think that there were other things that caused it?
Well, I think it's just a small symptom of how that the larger Hollywood industry is run in general. Like, none of it
rigidly. With rigid ideological beliefs enforced, you're only allowed to think and believe one way.
That, but publicly. Also just the like pay to play, like how it's all. There's nothing organic about it. There's no like, this movie's doing well because people like it. I just, maybe on some level, but it's all of the like hype for things is manufactured. All of the like endorsement deals they have with brands and stuff. It rings so hollow now. Whereas it didn't when I was younger, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And part of that's just the price you pay for growing up and realizing how things work.
Yeah, but it's also worse. It's worse because you are not, like, movies are not making money as much, or they're not successful anymore so much based on their financials, but, like, attention is now currency for some reason. Like, that's why the streaming wars, like, they're doomed to fail for everybody because they're competing not so much for dollars, but for eyeballs or for the perception of being the best one. Like, money is less important. Attention is the currency now.
Never trust any, like, when Netflix is like the number one movie on Netflix today. I'm like, according to who? You? Like, why am I like, oh, and it just so happens to be a Netflix original? Shocking. Like, am I supposed to buy that? Like, maybe it is, maybe it isn't. But outside of like imminently reportable statistics, why would I care what you tell me is the number one movie in the world right now? It's like when they have to parse through reviews to come up with like, it's like riveting on the trailers. It's like riveting garbage, and they just put riveting there. Like,
well, it used to be you'd watch a minute long preview and make a judgment in that time. I'm interested in seeing this or I'm not.
Also, they're like, I guess back then, a lot of people talk about how they wish we could go back to news similar to the, they're like, we need like a Walter Cronkite who just tells you the news. I'm like, even that's not realistic because what they choose to talk about already denotes what their beliefs are, what they think is important.
Mm-hmm.
But like, if we had something that was a media movie version of Walter Cronkite, it would have been Siskel and Ebert. And even then, like, not knowing a whole ton about it, I'm sure there's a lot of things that could be said about that, right? Because Siskel and Ebert lives on, or at least is it Ebert and Roper? And that's a website now, beyond just the people who did the reviews. But back then, the world was different, and you saw the world differently. So,
thanks for watching. Listen to full episodes of Pop Culture Crisis on Spotify.
Keep up with us on social media, and make sure you subscribe and ring that bell so you never miss the show. Bye, guys.